Here, so I think it's 12 o'clock at midnight in Burma at this time, where Pastor is. So I mentioned Wednesday night, when you're getting up in the morning, Pastor's usually probably about ready to go to bed. And when you get ready at night to go to bed, he's just getting up and starting his day, which makes it convenient for praying. Because before you go to sleep, you can pray and ask for God's direction on his life and protection and throughout the day, and then you fall asleep. See, and that's a pretty good thing. And then in the morning, you can get up and say, thank you, Lord, for giving him a good day. And he's going, give him a good night's rest now, and it works out real well that way. But there's about a 12-hour difference, so if you would remember him in this way. Let's pray. Father, I pray your Holy Spirit will speak and direct in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for the Word of God, and we pray that you use it to encourage us this morning, strengthen us, and help us, Lord, to live for you and to walk with you like we should. Lord, I pray that if there be one here that knows you not as Savior, today might be their day of salvation, and we'll thank you for that. We love you. Thank you for your love. We pray for Hilda's mom and dad now. We pray that you'll just give the doctors wisdom there and the situation there, and that you'll just heal their bodies and strengthen them and comfort and direct and guide and Hilda and her family this time, and we'll thank you for that. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your love. We pray for Pastor. We pray that you'll bless him. And direct and guide now as he'll be beginning these conferences. And we pray that your will be accomplished, and we'll thank you for it. We love you, and thank you for your love. In Christ's name, amen. Matthew chapter 16 is the first. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 14, 15 passages we're going to look at today. And if you're one that likes to just sit and look at one passage, sorry, I'm not going to do that today. I like to preach series of things, and it gives me something to think about all week long, and I can pray over it and meditate on it and throughout the week, but to just do this, you know, come and fill in once in a while is hard for me, and kind of on a personal note. But last Sunday, the Lord just laid this message on my heart, and it just came, and so it gave me all week, so I'm excited. I'm raring to go. And I hope you are too. I hope that this next week you'll be as excited thinking about what I said as I was this last week preparing. As you noticed in the bulletin, I've just simply entitled this message, The Church. I want to talk a little bit today about the church. I'm really not going to say anything that you probably have not already heard, but sometimes review is good. And I'm a teacher, and a teacher does a lot of reviewing. And so that's what we're going to do. First of all, we see the place of the church. The place of the church. When God created Adam and Eve, he formed the family. Shortly thereafter, at the time of Noah, he formed government. And then in the New Testament here, in Matthew chapter 16, he introduces to us the church. These are the three institutions that God has given in the world. They're the only three. And we need to see, particularly today, how the church works. So if you would, please, look at the Matthew chapter 16, look at verse 18. And I say also unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock... It's upon the saying that Peter had said there in verse 17. But I want you to notice now the next phrase. I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. What a statement. Do you realize, folks, that down through the years, since this time, man has done everything he can to destroy the church, and guess what we still have? The church. Why? It's like man has tried to destroy Israel, and Israel's still here. It's not going to happen. And likewise, the church is not going to be destroyed. And verse number 21 says, and from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things. In other words, up to that point, Jesus had been preaching the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom, and so on. But now all of a sudden he shifts gears. And he's going to introduce something new, and he introduces the phrase there, I will build my church. And we know that Jesus died, and he went back, he rose again, and he went back to heaven. And since that time, the church has been in the process of moving on down through the centuries. And here we are today. Now, as born again, saved people, we are members of the church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Now, the gates of hell may bombard it, and the gates of hell may do all kinds of things to destroy it, but listen. It's not going to prevail. God is going to prevail. And I don't understand people who think, oh, the church isn't important. I remember one time I was with a college organization when I was in college. I was a new Christian and learning, and we were down over at another university with some college students, and we were witnessing. And the guy that was leading the witness, he said, "Well, yeah," he said, "the church really isn't all that important anymore." I almost fell off my chair. I was a new Christian and didn't know a whole lot. To make such a statement, I said to the guy later, I said, why? I said, I know this much. The Bible teaches the church. And the Bible teaches the gates of hell. Why would you make that statement? Well, he said, the church is failing. Well, you're telling God he's not doing his job. And that's a dangerous place to be, folks. Now, turn with me, please, to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. Why is, I suppose we could ask, why is the church important? Why is the church the main thing? Well, let's look at it. Verse 23. Now, this talks in verses 20, 21 and following, talks about the husband and wife relationship. I don't want us to focus on that this morning. Focus on the idea of the word church here. Look at verse 23. For the husband is the head of the wife, even, now notice, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the husband, the wives be their own husbands and everything, and husbands, love your wives. Notice, even as Christ loved the church, and what did he do? He gave himself for it. Why did Jesus die? In a small sense, yes, he died for the sins of the world, but listen, he also died for the church. Folks, he gave his life for the church. Do you understand that? Do you realize that? For you and for me, he died. Now, who have you died for lately? My son, when he was asking his father-in-law, future father-in-law, if he could marry his daughter, the man said, Dwayne's his name, and Dwayne said to Jason, "Oh, how do you know you love her?" And Jason says, "I'm ready to die for her." And father-in-law says, "Good answer." But isn't that what Jesus did? God so loved the world that he died for the world as well. But here we see that he died specifically for the church. Now notice in verse 26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that by it should be holy and without blemish. Look at verse 29. For no flesh ever yet... For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourished and cherished it, even as the Lord the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is the great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. This whole passage here is talking about husbands and wives, yes, but the mystery is, it reveals and it demonstrates and it shows to us the church. Now listen, how do you live in your home? Pure and honest and holy and without blemish? Well listen, then in the church as you occupy your time here on the earth, you should be the same way, holy and without blemish, that God, that Jesus Christ might present it unto himself, a glorious church. The importance of the church. Go over with me, please, to 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 14. Paul's writing to Timothy, the pastor of this church, and he said, "These things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God." Notice now, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of truth, and without controversy. Great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of the angels, preached unto the world, unto the heathen nations, believed on in the world, received up into glory. Notice that little phrase there. Which is the church of the living God. Folks, today, God's system, God's direction of things is through the church. We can't get away from that. We can't go on Sunday morning out hunting and say, "Well, I'm worshiping God." That doesn't cut it with God. God says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. Why? Because, folks, listen, it is the church of the living God, which is the pillar and the ground of the truth. The importance of the church. Secondly, the place of the church. I'm sorry. Number two, the place of the pastor. God has directed and God has given to us pastors. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, please. Talking here, the first part of the chapter 4, talking about Jesus Christ and the various things. In verse 10, He that ascended up far above all heaven, that He might fill all things. Verse 11 now. And He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some what? Pastors and teachers. Now who gave the church pastors and teachers? Man? Is this man's idea? No. Folks, it's God's. Get a hold of that. It's God's idea. It's God's direction. It's God's understanding and God's working that He gave the church pastors. Turn with me, please, to 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 1, this is a true saying. If a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. What is the office of the pastor? Here it says, if a man desires that, he says, the Bible says, it is a good thing. It is a good thing. Now, parents, we need to pray that God would call our children to be pastors. Now, if He doesn't, that's fine. But we ought to pray that God would call and God would put in our children a desire to be pastors. Why? Because it's a good thing. Oh, please understand, God's not going to call every kid, every boy to be a pastor. And if He doesn't, don't be disappointed. You would rather not have him be pastor and be miserable than have him be a pastor. Now, am I saying this right? You know what I mean. I had a man that he was married and had a couple children, and we were together down there at Normal, and his wife taught, and he worked at Caterpillar, but he went through 3 years of seminary. And he came to the conclusion at the end of seminary, he said, God has not called me to be a preacher. Well, at the time I thought, I'm not sure I understand that, but as I've gotten older and thought about that, you know, that man was better off serving God at Caterpillar than he was being a preacher out of God's will. See? And so, don't, as parents, we would desire that, but listen, if it doesn't happen, pray that God will still use them. Whatever the job may be, the vocation, whatever that is. But listen, it says here that if a man desires that, it's a good thing. It's a good work. Turn over, please, to 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5, please. This is really a description, a good description of the job of a pastor. Look at verse 1. The elders who are among you, I exhort, who am also the elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ and also partaker of the glory which shall be revealed. Notice verse 2. Feed the flock of God which is among you. The job of the pastor is to feed the flock of God. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1. Verse 2. Feed them what? Now, I was a farmer. And, we fed the pigs slop. And we fed the cows hay. We fed the chickens. I don't know what we fed the chickens. But they ate just about anything. But what does a pastor feed the people? The Word of God. Have you been to a church? Have you ever been to a church where the pastor got up and read the paper every Sunday? Got up and read Time and News magazine? That's not the job of the pastor. The job of the pastor, folks, is to preach the Word of God. Feed the flock of God. What? The Word of God. I've had, since I've gotten saved, one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Pastor Hines is the sixth pastor I've been under all these years and however many years. But out of all the pastors I've had, two, Pastor Winninger and Pastor Hines, to me are the two best expository preachers of the Word of God I've had. I have grown so much under their ministry. Now, folks, you understand something. I'm seminary trained. I've been where they've been. And yet, they gather things and they glean things and they get things out of the Word of God that are... Where'd they get that from? Why? Because their job is to feed me. And if you come here and you sit here and you don't get fed, it's not Pastor Hines' fault, it's your fault. Because you don't come with the right attitude, you don't come with the right spirit. You see, folks, God has put Pastor Hines here as our pastor to teach us and feed us, and he is feeding us. And if you're not getting anything out of it, you better check your heart. I really mean that from the bottom of my heart. There's always, always, always something you can get out of the Word of God. When I was in seminary, we had preachers 3 times a week in chapel. And then there would be sometimes, you know, you'd just taken a hard test and your mind was just about ready to explode. And at least mine was. I don't know about anybody else's. But then you'd go to chapel and then you'd have some guy that was just as dry and you know, and just as boring. And he'd go on and he'd go on. But you know, I learned. Forget about everything else. Focus on what he's saying. And you'd be amazed at what you could learn. Look at it, verse 2. Not by constraint, but willing. Not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind. Verse 3. Neither is being lords over God's heritage, but being an example to the flock. And when the good shepherd shall appear, he shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. The job of the pastor. Let's go to the next one. 2 Timothy chapter 4, please. Go back to 2 Timothy chapter 4. It also describes a little bit more. Chapter 4. I charge thee, verse 1, 2 Timothy chapter 4, I charge thee therefore before the God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the living and the dead at his appearing. Preach the word. Be instant. In season, out of season. Excuse me. Someone has said that means if you feel like it or don't feel like it. You get up and you preach the word. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Now, let me ask you a question. Who's he to preach to? The church. Who's he to reprove and rebuke and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine? Not those walls back there, the people sitting in the chairs, and not the empty chairs. It's you and I. And if you get rebuked, then listen, take it as from God and correct your ways. Amen. Instead of going home and complaining about the way the preacher preached. We were talking in Sunday school this morning about Esau. He'd gone out hunting, and he brought his father, he got a venison, and he brought it, and he was going to get the blessing. And he came in, and he came in to his father, and he said, Father, I'm here to get the blessing. And the father says, what? Who was just here? And immediately, folks, Esau's disposition, total disposition changed. Here he'd come in, a happy-go-lucky, he'd gotten an animal, and boy, he's going to get a blessing. And Jacob fooled him. Jacob tricked his father, you know. What did Esau do? Esau hated Jacob. He should have got down on his hands and knees and said, God, what do I do now? I thought I was going to get the blessing, but instead you gave it to Jacob. God, what would you have me to do? But instead he rebelled and he turned his whole disposition. And listen, when the pastor preaches and he steps on your toes or he reveals something that's wrong in your life, what do you do with it? We have a tendency to blame and criticize. Oh, you know, this isn't right, or that isn't right, or this is wrong, and that is wrong. Instead of saying, my heart's not right, my heart's not right. I need to get things straightened out with God. I know it's not easy, it's not fun. I had a lady one time say, you know, I don't like to read those books on the home because I have to change my ways. What? Man, if those things will change your way and your home will be a blessing, go to it. That's my attitude, that's my thought. And so it is with us. But look at verse 3. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall heap up to themselves teachers having itching ears. And that's what we got, a society full of people with itching ears. Tickle my ears. Make me feel good. Well, listen, the Word of God makes us feel good. Paul says, rejoice. And again I say, rejoice. Do you rejoice? Paul says, in everything give thanks. In everything do you give thanks? Now, you talk about, you know, a moment's notice, something tragic can happen. You take, for example, Hilda gets a phone call this morning. Her mom and dad are in a bad accident. I mean, life is like that. Bang, it just happens. Well, what do you do with it when it happens like that? You become like Chicken Little, the sky's falling down? The world's going to end and everything is just disaster? That's the way some of you are. But listen, God's on the throne. God is in charge. He knows what's going on. The Bible says rejoice. The Bible says to be thankful. Look at verse 4. They shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables. But watch thou in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. That's a command given to pastors again. The direction, the guidance of a pastor. And then Paul gives a personal testimony, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. Go over to 1 Timothy chapter 5, please. 1 Timothy chapter 5. Verse 17. Let the elders rule well, be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in word and doctrine. For the scripture saith, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the grain, and the laborer is worthy of his hire. I don't know if you're aware of it or not, but we've fallen upon financial crisis here in our church. We had some pretty good givers leave our church, and our finances are quite a bit lower per month. What do we do? Do you know what Pastor did? He said, don't pay me. You ever gone into your boss and says, listen, we're having a hard time, don't pay me? I'll keep working here, but don't pay me? And here the Bible admonishes you and I. This is our responsibility to take care of our pastor, folks. And it says that he's worthy of double honor. We ought to be raising his pay. I don't have the answer. I don't know what the situation is. I realize that I'm designated as the treasurer of the church. And I can't figure these things out. But I do know this much. We've got a responsibility as a church to honor our pastor. And he's going to take what's left over at the end of the month, folks. Do you understand what Pastor Hines has done for us? So that the church can continue to go. We're going to pay the bills. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. But he says, don't pay me unless there's anything left over. Now, folks, we better look at that very seriously. Go to Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 6. One more thing about the pastor. Acts chapter 6, look at verse 4. Verse 2 says, then the 12, Acts 6, 2, then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them. It is not fitting, or it is not meet for, that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look among you for 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we appoint over this business, Why? Verse 4, that we may give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the Word. Listen, folks, that's the job of the pastor. He's to have time to study the Word of God, and he's to have time to pray. So that why? So that we can go back to the third point it was in 1 Peter, where he might be able to feed us. But listen, if we don't allow him time to pray and to study, how's he going to feed us? And then when we go home Sunday afternoon, we wonder, why didn't he feed us today? After Sunday school this morning, I was running around here trying to help with the water situation. And I mean, it was just back and forth and hither and yon, and my mind is going 100 miles an hour. Finally, I just had to go and get in a room by myself and just sit down and calm myself down, get my thoughts together. But listen, does pastor have time to do that? When we were building a new building down in Normal years ago, a new church building, one of the best things the church did was they hired a man who was the manager, and it was his job. And all Pastor Winninger had to do was meet with that guy. He met with no one else. And then that guy took care of all the problems of building the church. Building. And what a relief that was for him. Because then he could give himself to studying and to prayer like a pastor is supposed to. Now, the place of the church, the place of the pastor. Thirdly, the place of the members. Turn with me, please, to Ephesians chapter 4 again. Ephesians chapter 4. We read verse 11. And he gave apostles and some evangelists. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. What for? Why did he give those people? Look at verse 12. For the perfecting of the saints, that's the feeding and the building up of the saints, notice, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Who's to do the work of the ministry? Nobody wants the answer, because the answer is me. The answer is me. I'm supposed to be doing the work of the ministry. You see, folks, the pastor's job and the teacher's job is to teach, and then the people that hear the teaching, they're the ones that are to the ministry. How long? Verse 13. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature, the fullness of Christ, that we be henceforth no more children tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, by which they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up in him in all things, who is the head, even Christ. You see, the job of the pastor is to feed us and to teach us so that we don't become, as it says there in verse 14, children tossed to and fro. What do I do? Where do I go? No, he teaches us, he lays the foundation down for us, and then we get busy and we do the work of the ministry. Where do I give my money? It's very simple, to the church. The church, we have a responsibility to missionaries. We have a responsibility to all the various ministries we have here. I don't know if you're aware of it. I don't know if you really, really comprehend or really understand, folks. But listen, we have about 150 young people that walk in this building every day. And we as teachers, every day we're teaching them the Word of God and molding their lives. Now, yes, we'd like to have a church of 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 800 people. Wouldn't you? You know, sometimes churches get to be 200 people and people say, that's enough. We don't need any more people around here. You know, that's like saying, well, listen, I've got two children. That's enough. I'm not having any more. God said, fill the world with children. You're taking the command of... Likewise, listen. Maybe God doesn't want us to have a big church. Jonathan, in 1 Samuel, told his armor bearer, he said, listen, God can save by few or God can save by many. It doesn't make any difference to God. That's right. But listen, each and every one of us need to be doing our job and fulfilling our responsibility before God. Go over with me, please, to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Excuse me. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Look at verse 1. Moreover, brethren, we do you wit of the grace of God, or we make known to you the grace of God bestowed upon the churches of Macedonia. Paul's writing to Corinthians, and he's speaking of the churches of Macedonia. Notice verse 2. How there is that in a great trial of affliction and abundance of their joy and deep poverty abounded unto the riches of their liberality. Now, do you understand what that says? Those people are suffering. Those people are having a difficult time. And yet, look what it says of them. They, in their deep poverty, they're abounding in riches. Reminds me of and it says there too, I missed it, their joy. Pastor comes back from Burma and he talks about how joyful the people are. And what do they have? Listen, a few dollars feeds them all week long. Well, they're there for the whole conference. And listen, those people don't have anything. And yet, look what you and I have and how miserable we are. Well, listen, folks, things don't satisfy. Our relationship and our walk with God is what satisfies. But look at verse 5. And this they did, not as we hoped, but first gave themselves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God. They're doing what Paul had challenged them to do. They gave themselves. You know, they didn't just give their money. They gave themselves. Look at verse 7. Therefore, as ye abounded in everything, in faith and utterance and knowledge and in all diligence and in your love to us, see that ye abounded in this grace also. I speak not by commandment, but by occasion of the earnestness of others, and to prove the sincerity of your love. We sing, I love Jesus. Okay, do you? How do you prove it? How do you show it? How does a man prove to his wife that he loves her? He may have to die for her. You know, you heard the guy that said to his wife on their wedding day, I love you, it's the last time you're going to hear it from me. And she said, oh, no. She says, I need to hear that every day. Good for her. But what about your love for Jesus? Look at verse 12. For if there be first a willing mind, you see, it is accepted according to that which a man hath, and not according to that which he hath not. Now go back to verse 11. Now therefore perform the doing of it. See verse 12, it says you have a willing mind. Okay, then verse 11 says, now do it. That as there was a readiness to will, so there is a performance also out of that which ye have. Go to chapter 9, please. Look at verse 6. But this I say, he that soweth sparingly shall also reap sparingly. He that soweth bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth the cheerful giver. And who is Paul talking about here? He's talking about the folks in Macedonia who were poor. And they gave willingly, and they gave lovingly, and they gave out of grace, and they gave because they loved God. Not of necessity, but they purposed in their heart what they were going to give, and they gave it. Verse 8. As God is able to make all grace abound to you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. Look at that verse again. I'm going to read it a little bit slower. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. Listen, God's grace will enable you to do what you need to do. And as you do it, He will enable you to do more. That's our job. That's our responsibility, the place of the members. And I challenge you. I encourage you. I ask you, are you doing your responsibility because you love God? Let's pray. Father, we thank You for this time. We thank You, Lord, for these folks. And we pray Your Holy Spirit will just direct and guide in our lives. Help us, Lord, to walk with You like we should. Help us, Lord, to give our lives in all that we say and all that we do. And I pray, Lord, that You use this time to Your honor and glory. We love You and thank You for Your love. In Christ's name, amen. Hymn number 22. If you need to respond, we invite you to come. We're here to help you. If you need to come and pray, get things some right with the Lord, we challenge you to do that. Whatever the need, you come, as Pastor Mike leads us. Hymn number 22.
Let's stand as we sing, please.
The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is His new creation by water and the Word. From heaven He came and sought her to be His holy bride. With His own blood He bought her, and for her life He died. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth. Her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth. One holy name she blesses, partakes the holy food. And to one hope she presses with every grace undued.
On the fifth verse as the last.
Yet she on earth hath union with God the three in one. And mystic sweet communion with those whose rest is won. Oh, happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with Thee.
Let's close in a word of prayer, reminding you that we must close the service at this time, but the invitation is never closed. Let's pray. Lord God, I do thank You for the opportunity we had to hear Your word preached this morning. Thank You for Mr. Bo and just what You've impressed upon his heart to share with us this morning, God, talking about the church. I pray that we would see, that we would view the church the way You view the church through Scripture, and we would have a correct view of the church and a correct view of the pastor and a correct view of our place as the people, the members of the church. God, help us to grow every day. Help us to be more like You. And God, help us to follow Your biblical commands. For your name I pray. Amen. You're dismissed.